happened throughout the day made me very irritated. I didn't lash out at anyone or anything. I was just, I felt like angry. So it reminded me, when I was thinking about that today, it reminded me of the scripture, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6. It says, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you." Then it says, "Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you." One thing that the devil likes to do is get people that are alone or lonely. I used to be a loner. I used to like to be just by myself. I wasn't much being around people. I mean, I wasn't an antisocial, but I'd rather be by myself, you know, having my own pity party, than just be out with people and just reflect my desire to not be with them at that time. But that's not where I am anymore. And one thing that I believe he's trying to do is to get me back in that mentality, which is not going to work, because not only do I have this church family that loves me and are with me all the time, I have my friends, I have my immediate family, my blood relatives that are with me, and not only that, I also have God.
Yeah.
And he's with me. Which now takes me to Romans chapter 8, and I'm going to start from verse 31. "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord."
Amen.
I have all of you, I have my family, I have my friends, I have God. Nothing that the devil is trying to do is going to separate me from the love that God has for me. And as I said on Sunday, I'm going to set my mind in the things of above, because every good and perfect gift comes from above.
Yes.
And I know that if my gaze is set up on those things, none of that's happening around me is going to matter.
That's right.
Yeah. And I won't be taken down.
Amen.
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 You won't either.
Yeah.
Amen.
And I'm standing with you. So, with that, any prayer requests or testimonies? Tim.
Yes. I want to just thank the Lord for all the blessings he gives us. We was at school today, and our students tested. And it's always amazing how, today is one of the best days we've had. Just, you know,
who's home ill, Jody, Suzanne, who's got stuck at work, Peter, his work situation, Shelley, had an answer prayer. She was trusting in the Lord for a place to stay. Her living situation wasn't great, and God opened the door for her last Monday, the Lord opened up a door for a place to stay in Joaquin. So I just left it in the Lord's hands after praying for it, because she was ready to move to Colorado.
Ooh.
But the Lord kept her here, and thank the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Just speak against the tumors. He went back and the report was not good. He's, more tumors have grown on in his brain. He's conquered it once. He can do it again. And I wish you'd all just join with me and just
Amen.
Speak against those tumors.
Yes.
We have the power to
yes.
speak against it.
Yes.
They have no right in his body.
That's right.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Lifting up. Anyone else?
We're going to start taking her off the medication she's been on for this meningioma since she was 9 weeks old. So just pray that as we titrate her off, that it will not redevelop and everything will be good.
Amen.
Yeah. I say one other thing. I went to a Catholic church actually last night with a friend of mine. They're having missions and all this stuff for Lent. But this guy was not a priest or anything. He was just a layman, just kind of like we are, that comes and speaks and does motivational speaking. But his word was just so timely. I was just amazed. He was talking about God as a God of now. I mean, so many things that I'm like, oh my goodness, you wouldn't even know that he was really, you know, of that faith necessarily. And he was talking about, you know, people, you just need to understand, we are God. We are us and God are one. I mean, just all things that we've been saying. I mean, I was telling my friend, I'm like, oh my goodness. You know, I think it's kind of cool when you go to the church and you hear what the Lord's saying to people. I said, it's really cool that, you know, that the Lord has a universal message if people's ears are
That's
open,
right.
That it's not, you know, because of this or because of that, because you're this or because of that. But, I guess I was impressed with the whole message, because just three or four different things he said are just exactly the same thing that the Lord's been speaking to us. And to me, that was just a testimony. If people are hearing from the Lord, we just got to get out of our stereotype of, well, they're this or they're that or whatever, you know, because if you hear the voice of God, you're going to share it. And he's sharing it with everybody.
Amen.
And the funny part of it all was is now you can talk in the sanctuary because they've moved Jesus to this cubicle all the way in the back that he's hidden. So, because I know you didn't used to be able to, so she was explaining to me why. I'm like, I thought you guys weren't supposed to talk. She says, yeah, but we moved Jesus now.
Oh, man.
So, that was the worst part of it.
Put him in the corner.
Yeah.
That's fine. All right, anyone else? Okay, let's stand. Let's come to the Lord tonight. Father, we thank you for bringing us here tonight in your presence. Thank you, Lord, for manifesting in this place, for giving us your word, for the testimonies that have been shared, Lord, that serve as proof, Lord, of how good you are. We thank you, Father, for all the blessings that you give us, for giving us your spirit, Lord, a spirit that operates within us. When we speak your word, Lord, it says you are speaking your word unto any situation. So right now we declare, Lord, that anyone that is suffering from any illness, from any sickness, any disease, right now we declare that that is gone in Jesus' name. It has no place in that person's body.
You are worthy, Lord.
We are not a person, Lord.
We love you. You are worthy.
Thank you, Father. We know that you have declared us healed. And that healing is manifesting right now as we speak it, Lord, with your mighty name, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for all the good things that you do, for keeping us safe at all times, for when we go out into this world and share who you are, people listen. We thank you, Father, for giving us that boldness that we can go out and speak of your name to whoever comes in our path. Thank you, Father, for your permission. For loving us the way that you do, for calling us your children. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for all the good and wonderful things that you continue to do in our lives every day. loving us so much that you gave your only son to die for our sins, even when we weren't thought of. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you for being so good to us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for all the answered prayers. In your mighty name, Jesus. March 11th, 7 p.m. A week from Friday, mm-hmm. Eastern Gate House of Prayer.
Pressing in.
What are
you hearing? Pressing in. The gate's open. We're going to the rest of the way.
Praise God. All right.
It's already manifesting through the city and different places.
Amen.
All right, well, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not
revive us again?
That your people may rejoice in you. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction of this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom, revelation, and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes and devours for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Thank you, Jesus.
James, would you mind taking the offering, please?
Worship the Lord.
There's a wind blowing, and all across the land, the fragrant breeze of heaven blowing once again. Don't know where it comes from. Don't know where it goes. Let it blow on me. As you want, consume this heart that longs to burn. I know your fire can hurt, but I will be worse here without you. For I was made to dwell. Your kingdom, Lord. Come and take all these chains that get in the way of what you want. The old mindsets, the old ways, Lord. And in the flame, still I will trust. My verse 2. Come and take all these chains, they get in the way of what you want. Your kingdom, Lord, your kingdom. And as I stand in the flame, still I will say, I trust you, God. For I was made to dwell with you. And
tonight. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings, for your favor. Thank you, Lord, for all that you do in our lives, the seen and the unseen, Lord. Thank you for your hand of protection upon us. Thank you for healing our bodies, Lord. Thank you for saving us,
Lord.
Keeping us, Lord, delivering us.
Yes,
we give you all the praise,
yes,
all
Lord.
The glory and all the honor. You
yes,
are great
yes.
and greatly to be
yes,
praised.
Lord.
What a mighty God
yes,
we serve.
Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. We love you. We bless your name.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, the Eastgate Trio. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you. You did a good job. Hallelujah. Good job. I'm not saying what Mike said. I'm just saying the trio. Praise the Lord. They're good. Hallelujah. God is good. Amen. You know, we say all the time how that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose. And I was here yesterday and I was just doing some cleaning and studying and some other stuff. And I went out to take some trash out to the street because they pick it up on Wednesdays. And so my routine is usually to take it out Tuesday afternoon. So that sure that they get it on Wednesday in case I'm not here, although I was here today. But anyway, as I went out, I forgot my keys, and I locked the door accidentally behind me. So everything's in the church, including the keys to the truck. I couldn't get my truck. The phone was in the church. Everything was locked up. So I'm thinking, oh, man, okay, what do I do here? Break out a window, you know? So I looked across the street. There was some the door wasn't open. The interior door was open, but the storm door was there, you know. So I thought, well, I'll check it out. So I went over, knocked on the door. This young guy came to the door, and I said, you know, I pulled a real bonehead deal over here. I said, I locked myself out of the church, and I was wondering if I could use your phone to call my wife and have her bring a key down here to get me in, because everybody else is working. Everybody else is probably on the job, so I wouldn't be able to get a hold of him. And he said, sure, sure. And then he apologized about parking out in front. I said, hey, it's on street parking. You know, I mean, that's, anybody can park there. It's the street, you know. I mean, it doesn't bother me any. And got to talking a little bit. And I called Sally, and she was on her way. And he had just come home for lunch is what the deal was. And otherwise, he wouldn't have been there. But he said, come, you might as well stay in here. It's cold. And till I get ready to leave. And I said, well, I appreciate it. So I sat down. We got to talking. And he told me about the last time he had gone to church. His boss had invited him to their church. This is a young guy. He's got kind of long hair and the nose piercings. And I mean, a typical young person, you know. And I didn't think anything of it, but he said they really made him feel uncomfortable and unaccepted, you know, at that church. He just felt really bad about after he went, and he kind of left a bad taste in his mouth. So it gave me an opportunity then to share the Lord with him, the true reality of God, his love for everyone, and how, you know, he's reaching out to them. And he was talking about his girlfriend. They just had a baby not long ago, and how she just doesn't want any part of any kind of religion. And my guess is she's probably had a bad experience somewhere along the way too, like a lot of people. But it gave me about 20 minutes to just sit there and share the love of God, not for any ulterior motive, not to, you know, force them into anything other than just to let them be exposed to a God of love, a God of acceptance, a God who wants to be in relationship with them. So it was great. I mean, I got to spend that time. I said, look, I don't want to keep you. I know you got a job, and I don't want to be over here getting you in trouble and keeping you from getting back to work. So I said, I got a sweater and a shirt on. I'll be fine. My wife will be here in 10 minutes. The sun was shining, so I came over and sat down on the front steps. And as he was locking the door, he looked over at me and he hollered. He said, you know, why don't you just come over and stay, and then you can just lock up after your wife gets here. No, come on. I said, I appreciate it. I'm not going to stay in somebody's house when they're not there. Anything, you know, any bad thing could happen, and then I'd be accountable. But it really touched me that he was willing to do that, just leave me in his house, you know, and just, you know, lock the door when you leave, you know. So hopefully we were able to plant some seed there, and they'll kind of loosen up a little bit. But I told him about how we have service. I said, we're trying to get everybody, we want everybody involved. Everybody has a relationship with the Lord that's a little bit different than others, and so that we try to share that with one another. And I said, so, you know, because he talked about, well, we thought about coming over, but, you know, my girlfriend really is not into this at all. And I said, well, you know, it's not a question of being into anything. It's just a question of being open to God's love. You know, that's all we're really offering here. It isn't like, you know, there's some great catechism that you got to go through or rituals or anything else. Just come with an open mind and an open heart, and God will meet you. You know, he'll be there for you. So anyway, it was a great experience. And again, what looked like was going to be a catastrophe and a very aggravating situation turned out to be a real blessing, an opportunity for God to speak into somebody else's life, and an opportunity for, that's always, we always get blessed, you know, when we get a chance to do something like that. It's always good for us, because the anointing's always there when you're sharing Jesus, you know. So it turned out to be a really good thing. Praise the Lord. So thank you, Jesus. Remember to pray for that couple across the street, and we'll just believe God will move on their hearts. Praise the Lord. Okay, so for tonight, I want to get right into this so I don't keep you late, because it's snowing somewhere tonight. We have no idea where. I just saw the forecast, and it's supposed to be someplace. You know how specific the weathermen are.
Yep.
We're going to have bad weather somewhere, and other places it won't be so bad. And the sun will, should come out tomorrow, praise the Lord. Or at least it'll come up, praise God. Amen. So it was weird, though. Sally drove up Highway 65, which is her normal routine, and it was snowing like crazy over there. She gets here, and there's nothing. Well, I came through Altoona, and it was snowing in Altoona. By the time I got to the east side of Des Moines, it was nothing. So, who knows? I may have to follow a snowplow to get through Altoona, but it should be good after I get on the other side. I'm hoping anyway. Praise the Lord. All right, let's start, Roberto, if you will, in John chapter 8. And I want to read verses 32 and 33. John 8, 32 and 33. My wife told me that she thought Sheila and I were going to get into it Sunday because I kept saying I got to tell you, I'm usually thinking ahead. Now, this isn't because I'm really deep. It's just that my mind kind of gets ahead of me sometimes, and I'm thinking of the next thing that's coming. And I'm looking back, and I looked up, and I saw one scripture up there, which was wasn't the last scripture I saw, but there was just one scripture, you know, instead of all three. And so I just looked up and thought, well, we're still at the same scripture. And so I'm turning back, and Sheila's trying to tell me. And, of course, I'm really not thinking about anything except something other than what I'm supposed to be thinking about until I finally realized, oh, that is the scripture. So anyway, it really wasn't as big a deal as my wife thought, but but it might have seemed that way to everybody else. So I'm just letting you in on this. My wife takes a lot of grief, but she's a good... good woman, praise the Lord. She'd have to be put up with me all these years. If I didn't have her, I wouldn't have anything to say about half the time. So praise God. Good thing she's hanging in there with me, praise the Lord. So anyway, here we go. John chapter 8, verses 32 and 33. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free.
Amen.
They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Praise God. Now, my problem, when I think of freedom in these terms, I'm always thinking that everything should be perfect, you know, that including me. I wouldn't sin or fail or hurt anybody or do any damage in any way. I'd be free, you know. So freedom gets distorted into an idea that I get what I want, you know, but that's not really freedom. What if the only way we experience freedom is by being invited into it? Not something we achieve or something we attain, but something that we are just invited to experience. I know that sounds kind of strange, but I believe that's how freedom really works. In Matthew 11, if you will, Roberto, Matthew 11, verse 27 through 30. Let's take a look at this. Matthew 11, 27 through 30. All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father, neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest in your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Now, that rest is really a kind of freedom. And Jesus is inviting us into that experience. When here we are all scrounging around trying to get free from sin, you know, bad feelings, pain, addictions. But in spite of all of our attempts to fix ourselves, we're still here, not free. Still struggling, still dealing with all this stuff. But what if freedom... the freedom that we're looking for, what if it only exists in a home that we've been invited into? Praise the Lord. How many of you know at home you're a lot freer than you are in somebody else's home? See, I got this thing. We go every once in a while. We were invited to go down to Arizona this year and stay with friends. They were going to pay our plane fare down there. It was kind of a stay longer than we really could, but we couldn't do it because for several reasons, one of which is just it was for too long of a time, and the second is I'm just not comfortable in other people's houses, you know, for a long period of times, you know what I'm saying? You get up in the night, you want to use the bathroom, you're stumbling around, you know, you got to get completely dressed, and, you know, it's just awkward, and so it really doesn't work real well for me. So, I'm just saying, but in my house, I'm free. I just feel totally at home, at peace, at free. I feed myself. I can do whatever I want to do, whenever I want to do it, however I want to do it, you know. It's just a different feeling. But Jesus is trying to get us to understand that he's inviting us into a house where freedom reigns, where it exists all the time.
Right.
Amen. It is the reality of that home. Amen. Mm-hmm. So let's look at this in Isaiah chapter 4, verses 4 through 6, Roberto. Isaiah 4, 4 through 6. When the Lord shall have washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion, and shall have purged the blood of Jerusalem from the midst thereof by the spirit of judgment and by the spirit of burning, the Lord will create upon every dwelling place of Mount Zion and upon her assemblies a cloud and smoke by day and the shining of a flaming fire by night. For upon all the glory shall be a defense. And there shall be a tabernacle for a shadow in the daytime from the heat, and for a place of refuge, and for a covert from storm and from rain. Praise the Lord. Mm-hmm. Then Revelation chapter 21, verses 3 through 5. Revelation 21, 3 through 5. A tabernacle, or a shadow from the heat in the day, and a shelter. Amen. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. Praise God. So a relationship that is so special, so perfect, that the experience of it would set us free. Free to be who we truly are in Christ.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. That home does exist, amen. It has for all of eternity. In fact, before time began, throughout eternity past. And Jesus invites us into this house. It's Jesus inviting us into it, amen. Exodus chapter 2, verses 23 through 25. Yes. Exodus chapter 2, 23 through 25. This is what I heard from the young man yesterday and another fellow that had called and wanted to have some, I don't like calling it counseling, he just wanted somebody to talk to, basically, and so I spent a couple hours with him here today. And this is what I hear and have heard from people all of my pastoral life, at least, if not before that, just didn't recognize it, but it came to pass in the process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage, and they cried. And their cry came up unto God by reason of the bondage. God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham and Isaac and with Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect unto them. Amen. Exodus 3, verses 7 through 10. So God hears the cry of our hearts. He hears the cries of other people's hearts that are crying out because of their bondage, because they're bound, because they can't be free by their own abilities. And God said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them. Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And the scripture teaches us that it's for freedom that Christ has made us free. And the cry, the heart cry that I hear from people, although it may not be expressed perfectly in language, but it's what you hear underneath all the words that are being said. There's a cry that comes out from every human who is not free in Christ, who doesn't have a relationship with Jesus. And that cry is that I'm trapped. I don't know how to describe my trapped condition. I just know that I want loose. I want free. And I don't know how to get there. Can somebody help me? Can somebody get me free? Can somebody point me to somebody, amen, that can get me free? Praise the Lord. So Galatians chapter 5 and verse 1. It is for freedom that Christ has made us free, that we might experience true freedom, the freedom of relationship with God, of safety and security in Christ, freedom from all of the fear and the anxiety and the stress that we deal with in the world, and freedom from our own inadequacies, our own inabilities to find the path that God has for us. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Praise God. So we know, humanity knows, that we are designed for freedom. We know that we are, but in a very real sense, we can't seem to get there. We can't keep it. We can't actualize it for ourselves because we know that we aren't the way we're supposed to be. Praise the Lord. That's what you hear from people all the time. That's the great struggle of everyone's, even for us as Christians, but especially for people who don't have a relationship with the Lord. The thing about humans is that we were made for a very particular type of freedom. Amen. Let me ask you something. You know, would we know freedom if we saw it? I know back in the 60s, we thought we were going to get free by letting our hair grow, you know, and smoking dope and just traveling all around and doing whatever it was. We thought we were going to get free until we found out we just exchanged one set of bondage for another set of bondages. That's what you see with people all the time. That's what I hear coming from the hearts of people every time I sit down and listen to them, is underlying everything else that they're saying is, I want to be free. I want to be free from all of this junk, but I don't know how. How can I get free? And the problem is sometimes we don't even know what freedom is when we see it, when we're involved with it. Amen? So maybe it's that the cry that we hear in the Scripture and the cry that we feel in ourselves and hear from other people is coming from a world that is totally confused about what true freedom looks like.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Romans chapter 6, verses 4 through 8. Man I talked to today was saying, you know, all I really want is relationship.
Woo!
Now, he wasn't talking about Jesus, but it's the heart cry. And the truth is, we can never really have real, true relationship without a relationship with Jesus first.
Mm-hmm.
Everything else suffers without that. But you can't get the cart in front of the horse. Sometimes you have to kind of gradually work up to that relationship and help them to understand what they're really looking for. Because they don't really know what real freedom is. They don't know what real relationship is. That's the cry of their heart. That's the deepest desire that they have, but they don't really know what that is. Praise the Lord. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Remember Jesus said that? Back in Revelation, we read it just a moment ago in Revelation 21, he makes all things new. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Praise the Lord. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. It's relationship with God. Amen. Jesus showed us what real freedom is. Praise God. One with God. That's the only way anybody can ever be free, no matter what you try to do. You can go buy yourself an island somewhere, rip off your clothes and go running naked through the jungle, but you're still not free. You're just going to look like an idiot. Praise the Lord. You're going to have mosquito bites and rashes and all sorts of stuff, but you're not really free. Praise the Lord. There's only one real freedom, and that comes with being one with God. So what's our cry? What is the cry of the people that we interact with all the time? Freedom. Freedom from a habit that they can't shake. Freedom from debt. Freedom from, you know, broken relationships. And freedom from doubt. And I think the biggest freedom that they're looking for is freedom from fear that God really doesn't like me or God really doesn't love me. And they just get tired of the treadmill of life, of just going through the motions, but never really getting to where it is they're hoping to get to. Praise God. Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. see anger in people, frustration in people, almost all of it comes from the same place. This sense of being confined and being controlled and being manipulated, not having freedom, not having the relationship that their heart really cries out for, even if they don't know that. Amen. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Praise God. So we are invited to experience the freedom that will put us on the road to live fully, to love boldly, and to fear nothing. Praise God. And that's because all is grace inside of the love of God. That's the heart cry that each one of us has, and that is the cry of the heart of every human being on this planet. God put eternal life into them, or he put a hunger for God life in every living thing. Praise the Lord, every human being. And spirit life, this free life that we're talking about today, is defined by unbridled joy. You can have joy even when you're not happy. Amen. You can still have this joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's defined by daring courage. Why? Because we have no fear of death. The only fear that's really that dominates people is I'm going to die. Well, praise the Lord. Paul said, to die is gain, to live is Christ. We ought to apply that to our own lives. Amen. Praise the Lord. It's defined by rebellious courage, rebelling against the culture, the society, the political correctness, the demands of cultures that think that the Bible was written for somebody 2,000 years ago, but it doesn't apply today. This thing was written, doesn't matter how many thousands of years ago that it was written and it spoke of things that haven't even come yet.
Right, exactly.
Praise. It's not antiquated, it's not outdated. It's way ahead of its time. It's always going to be beyond anything that we can imagine. If the Lord would tarry for another 1,000 years, this book will still be relevant. It'll still be speaking into people's lives. It'll still be changing people's lives. And it'll still be revealing the God of glory. Amen.
Amen.
And it's defined also by risky faith. Mm-hmm. Amen. Where we just take risk because we trust that if God is for us, who can be against us? If we're one with God, amen. If we have died with Christ, then our life is in Christ. We are comforted by the fact that we know that God will never leave us or forsake us. Amen. We could take some risk because of faith. Praise the Lord. That's freedom. That's the freedom that people are looking for. And that freedom of being at home in Jesus, it's risky, it's dangerous, it's unpredictable, but it's secure. Praise God. Couple more scriptures and we'll wrap up here. Romans chapter 8, verse 7. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can it be. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 4. So this is the struggle when we deal with people. If we try to deal with them intellectually, we never get past that carnal mind. You have to deal with the spirit, with the heart of the person, because that's where the cry comes from. It doesn't necessarily come from an intellectual reasoning out of things and saying, you know, I think I've come to the conclusion that this is what I need to do. It's a heart cry.
Yes.
It's something that from deep inside that they can't really explain or define. So, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. The strongholds that keep people in bondage, that keep them trapped in their unfree condition. Amen?
Amen.
Their separation from God, in other words. Amen. They want to be fixed, but they can't fix themselves any more than we can.
Right.
Amen? Mm-hmm. Now, I go to Menards and Home Depot and Lowe's and those kind of places all on a fairly regular basis. And tools are nice. You know, I've got a whole section in my basement. It's not very well organized, but there's all kinds of tools there. And I'm not a real handy man. I can do a few things, as long as it's not too complex. But I'm not a real handy man. That's why when I worked in building houses, I just did rough end carpentry. Because you can make mistakes and it all gets covered by the drywallers or the painters. Somebody else will come along and fix your mistake. So I'm not a real, you know, craftsman by any means. In fact, my theory is that anything that duct tape can't fix, more duct tape can. So when you go to Menards and those places, I'm always looking for duct tape because I know I'm going to need it. I got a job coming up, praise the Lord. And my feeling is, duct tape can't fix it, then just get some more duct tape. You'll get her fixed eventually. Get her done, praise the Lord. Now, my wife really doesn't believe that, and I got to admit she is right. But religion is like duct tape. It's just trying to jury-rig something together. You know, the Rube Goldberg kind of idea of getting people to Jesus. Just patch it up and push them on down the road, you know? Praise the Lord. God is the master builder. Amen. He's the master mechanic. He's the master architect. Praise God. So let's trust the Holy Spirit of God to not only fix and transform us, but to fix and transform the people that he puts in our path. We operate not by flesh and blood, not carnal weapons, but by the Spirit of God. God has put it in us. Be able to minister to other people, even if we don't think we have the tools to do it.
Yes.
Amen. If we'll just allow the Holy Spirit to speak through us, amen, you'll be amazed at the impact that it can have on other people's lives. Praise the Lord. So let's let God not only transform us and fix us and set us free, but then let him work his grace and his love through us to heal, to deliver, to restore, and to redeem those that God has ordained for us to encounter and interact with. Praise the Lord. Let's finish with this scripture, John 8, verse 36. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Amen, amen. God bless you. Go in the liberty of Jesus. Amen. See what God won't do through you. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here tonight. Hope we'll see you all back here Sunday. Stay safe. Praise God. Be free in Jesus' name.